Hello everybody, this is Vince Ornato again with The Creative Process. Today we're going to do a segment on portraiture, and I'm going to be using pastel.
The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. Vince is a professional Pittsburgh artist that works in many mediums. And now Vince is going to share his creative process with you.
What I want to show you right now is the great amount of pastel I have, and it's not enough. I probably have 700 pastels total. Rembrandt set, new pastel set, Othello pencils, they're pastel pencils. Ones that I acquired here and there over the years, old Grumbacher sets, but it's the same stuff. I have a Sennelier set. My teacher, Daniel Green, has about 3,000 pastels. One of the problems with pastel, you can only do one color and about two values out of each stick. With oil paint or any kind of paint, you can mix every color under the sun with just black and white and the primary colors. So a lot of times when people get into pastel, they get frustrated because it's new and they don't want to spend a lot of money yet. So they get a set which may have 40 sticks, and that feels like a lot. And you can do some things with that, but it's actually very limiting because you can't mix pastel the way you can with paint. So I would recommend, if you're serious about it and you want to start into it, acquire a good set. The neat thing about pastel is they last a lot longer than oil paint, which you obviously have to replace, talking money expenditures and things like that. But I just wanted to point that out first. A little bit of a comment on a paper. There's a lot of good papers out there. Canson, MTN's a French brand. I never did learn how to pronounce that properly, but these manufacturers have been around for literally over 100 years, and they're very good papers, meaning that the painting that you do on it will last an extremely long time. Surprisingly, because pastel is a dry medium, meaning there's very little blender mixed with it, as in oil paint, there is oil, obviously, and that pastel is dry. It actually has a long quality pastel. Has a longer shelf life, so to speak, than oil paint. Pastel is not chalk. For $3, you can buy 50 sticks of chalk. Pastel is a high-quality art material that has a very long life if framed properly under glass. On the paper issue, the manufacturers often recommend the side that kind of has a dot pattern on it, and I think we've all seen artwork, color pencil, graphite, pastel, that pattern can be seen through the picture that the artist painted. Actually, the opposite side is better to work on, even though the manufacturer recommends the pattern side. That is because you won't be interfered with by the pattern. Once in a great while, maybe somebody wants to use that pattern as an idea in the painting. You know, you're free to do so. No one's going to take you to prison, and I won't call you up about it. But it's just something to note that the side with the least amount of visual pattern to it is actually the better one to work on. Ideally, you would want a background drape that is perfectly matched to the paper. You can't always have that, obviously. But I do have a green background drape and a green paper. This is a yellow green. The background drape is an emerald green. Those who've seen the show before know I talk a lot about warm and cool colors. This green tends to be warmer. That green tends to be cooler, but in no way is green a warm color. It is always cool. So the reasons you should have a background drape as close as possible to your paper should be obvious. That just helps the eye when you're working together. Imagine if I had a red background drape and a green piece of paper or something like that. It's extra work that your eye is going to be fooled with. You might have a a deep gray background drape, you have a deep gray paper, and so on and so on. So that's something I wanted to point out. As far as for those that are really kind of very new at this, notice on the model's face there's a dark side and a light side, a dark middle tone, light highlight. Light is coming almost entirely from one direction, our right, her left. You will see the further back you go in time, looking at portrait studies, that's extremely common. In a way, it's nicknamed Rembrandt lighting, but the idea is it's a great way to solidify the form. When you have light coming from different angles, the solidity, the structure, the form starts to weaken. So this is why it's very common to see this in portraiture. In nature, you could be outside, and because of movement of clouds and things like that, light begins to conflict with itself. But even at that, for the solidity of the painting, you know the sun is in one spot. And it may travel, it will travel if you're doing a couple hours of painting on location, but you want to lock in a position on the painting, and we've talked about some of that before. As far as the portraiture itself, portraits are really the most difficult subject for plenty of reasons. One, it's a very complex subject. Two, you have to get a likeness. And there's maybe 25 to 30 elements on a face that lend to people's likenesses. It's the same with the overall body and things. People walk and stand in unique ways, you know, individualized ways. When you do paintings of trees and so on and so on, believe me, there's a lot of inaccuracies in there, but it still looks like a tree. And, you know, the inaccuracies a lot of times come with the movement of the sun and the shadows and things like that. But you're on location and you're trying to do your best. The inaccuracies don't work with portraits because you'll begin to lose the likeness and the structure. So if you get frustrated with portraiture, keep at it, because you're not alone. It is a very, very difficult subject. A great exercise, by the way, is to get a black and white photograph with a single light source, like I talked about, turn it upside down, and do a drawing of that photograph entirely upside down. The reason it really is a good exercise, it really trains your eye to see structure and form and not eyes, nose, and mouth and that kind of thing, which is what we all do in the beginning. And you'll be stunned if you can discipline yourself to do it. The first time it's really hard because you want to turn it right side up. But you'll be stunned when you turn it right side up how accurately you did it upside down. In fact, many paintings that I do start from photographs, I should say, in the studio, I almost always begin the drawing with the photograph upside down. It's a little tidbit secret that you can have it now. So, and again, so the lighting, we have the highlight is on the upper top of her head. That's the overall highlight. Each individual section, each individual part will have its own dark middle tone, light highlight. And there's an overall dark middle tone, light highlight. What we do, we start with the drawing, then we move into the darks. When I was starting out, I thought you started with the lights and then went darker. No, to get the structure happening early, you want to begin with the darks, but do not make it as dark as it really is. You want to go somewhat lighter than that. The first time around, when you get to the lights and highlights, you want to make those darker than they really are to give yourself room to lighten later. And on the dark issues in the beginning, when you first do the darks on a piece, you don't want them as dark. You want to give yourself room to darken and correct as you go along. A lot of this, and a lot of painting, if you think of it in terms of a hunk of clay just laying there, you're molding it, shaping it, making it solid. And drawing and painting is a lot like that. So much of it is correction and altering and things like that. You'll see more of that as we go along. As folks who have seen the show before know, I always like to do a book recommendation. Without a doubt, this is the best book on pastel by Daniel Green. Green with an E on the end. It's simply called Pastel. Dan is the world's foremost authority on pastel in the Pastel Hall of Fame and the Oil Painter Hall of Fame. Get it if you're interested in pastel. another issue involved in this, I talked about divisions of lengths, like the sections vertically. Another issue, obviously, are the widths. So that's not as easily seen because everyone's face is really different on that issue. And you have to practice this. This is not, you know, I can't just say get out the ruler and do all these things. Your eye and accuracy develops from drawing. So what we're doing, I'm kind of looking at what I believe would be the middle of the face, and then I'm kind of note-taking to work out from the middle. Not a fan of egg-shaped ovals and working from the outside in. You tend to be inaccurate like that. What you really want to be thinking about is working from the middle out, and so that, you know, for example, the nose, and I'm going to be doing this much a little more rapidly than I normally would, and I won't end up with a completed portrait today, but I'll end up with hopefully transferring some information about the process. So that's what I'm doing now. I'm looking more at the division of widths than lengths, although I'll be adding that in as I go. I'm already getting a resemblance because it's, you know, accuracy is decent, so I'm already getting a resemblance. Something also to note is I'll often check in the mirror. Obviously a mirror, just a regular old mirror, nothing fancy about it. And I'll close one eye when I do this. I'm left eye dominant. The reason the mirror helps, when you look at it in the mirror, you're looking at the piece for the first time because it's a reverse image. That helps you see things that need corrected by looking in the mirror right away. So that as you go along, a lot of the issues are mistakes, we'll call them, are made in the first couple minutes. That's why the start needs to be pretty darn accurate. It doesn't have to be perfect. There's room to adjust later. But these things of lengths, of sections vertically and then horizontally, are the structure that the form is built on. I'm not a fan at all, in no way, of the left brain, right brain analysis that non-artists always impose on creative people, because there's so much analysis that goes into this. And as near as I can figure, you use your entire brain. And those are just types that are always trying to measure talent. I've probably read 100 articles about that. Not one of them mentions practice and hard work. They all are trying to find some kind of secret or some kind of whatever to explain talent. And really, it's a byproduct of labor and work. It's not something you're born with. You're born with potential, and you develop the potential from working at it. So what I'm going to do now, I got a little bit of a start here, and I'm going to move to a deeper color. I'm going to check it in the mirror. I'm sure you could see that pretty well on the screen, what I have. It's a little long, okay, and I have a tendency to do that. And there's certain issues I need to shorten. So I then go to kind of like a little bit of a darker color. And I'm going with a very light touch right now. Now as I have this started, and then the length of the neck, one of the things you can do, if you extend, you see artists do this, even cartoons and things, but this is real. If you extend your arm as long as you can and then close one eye and find some measurements, I'm trying to see where the base of her neck would be. So I use other parts, like the top of her eyebrow to the bottom of the nose or whatever, as a measuring device to see how far down, and then do it here on the piece. And you want to err in a direction of a little short. You can always lengthen. You can see I'm already getting a resemblance, but it's based on these elements. It's not really math. It kind of sounds like math, but how far apart are things, how close together are they, that kind of thing. When I look through the mirror here, I'm looking at what I drew and her at the same time. That's why I'm holding the mirror horizontally instead of vertically. I'm trying to get both in the same, in the mirror at the same time, so that I bounce my eye back and forth. If you look at the model, there's something on it, in my mind, her right side underneath her ear. You can see that deep dark. That's what this is here. Okay, and I'm doing it lightly. I don't want to put too much pastel down right now. She has one of those underneath the top of her forehead here, created basically shadow created by the hair, and a little bit over here. I'm not worrying about great accuracy of color at the moment, that kind of thing. Always, 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 I'm thinking first in terms of value and warm and cool. I use a mall stick. This is called a mall stick often. Now I'm gonna get into the eyes. If you look at the top of her eyelid, there's dark, and again, it's part of the drawing. And I'm not going as dark as it really is. I'm coming off it a bit so that I have room to darken later. It's a little easier to darken these darks than lighten them if I overshot it. When I come down the nose, I'm going to switch to different color. And this is where all these different pastels come in. All faces have warm and cool colors. I'm going to come back and draw some of the structure of the shadow coming down. So what you see here, I'm looking for darks in the hair. You can't do them all at once like snapping your fingers. You have to build them. And you can see how this is getting more solid. If you're looking at her eyes in her right or left, the right side is actually darker than where the high obvious highlight is. So that's what I'm looking at right now. And that's what I'm building on. One of the things I personally fight against, because I've done so many caricatures at events, parties, and weddings and so on, I have to really fight against that, so to speak. You know, this is a realistic portrait. One of the things you can do is testing the background color. Do it up away from your subject, because you can work towards it as you, you know, change your mind and so on. If you start too early on the background color, you're getting ahead of yourself, and it's harder to correct later if you need to. So the reason I'm doing it now, it's kind of a way for me to cut back a little bit. I'm really making a note to remind myself that this part of the hair, the way I rendered it, is a little too high. So it's really kind of a way to make a note that I did that. So now I can come back. A lot of this is my teacher, Daniel Green would have said, a lot of this is preparation right now at this stage. That's great. Another important issue with pastel is this thing of blending. I'm doing this with values and color. I'm creating the structure and the form with values and color, not blending colors together with my finger and rubbing them and mixing them that way. The more pastels you have, the more pieces you have, the more you're able to do that kind of thing. If you work lighter than it eventually will be, you can put colors on top of each other. That's not the prime consideration, but it's done to strengthen drawing or to be more accurate, but it's not really a way to create color, I should say. But and of course they're going to butt up against each other, and there will be some overlapping. But as far as, there's people that get, oh man, they heavy amount of green, heavy amount of blue, and they'll blend them together, rub them together is maybe a good word. You don't want to do that. Okay, so I'm going to move more into middle tones now. As you see, Molly's skin tone, it almost moves from some cool shadows into a redder, warmer middle tone. That's orangish. I want more red. English red, if any pastel portrait artist will tell you, these old Grumbacher English red color is used a lot. It just sort of works out that way. It's no hard and fast rule, but you find yourself going to it. You can see the paper at this point is still coming through, because I'm not doing a hard and fast covering. Of because I want to give myself room later to put basically more pastel down, and that'll strengthen. I'm just looking for these mid-tone colors in the face. Notice there's more darks on the right side of her face or the left. I'm moving from the darks more into the middles, and then I got to search through my pastels. And I usually pick out a couple at a time, lay them in my hand, and test them. A lot of this is testing right now, which colors would work in her hair. Here we go. Sometimes you spend 10 minutes looking if you have a lot of pastels. By the way, a great thing to do when you get your, if you get a set of 200 or something like that, it takes time, but it's well worth it. Put a piece of tape around the middle and number them. And you could put them back in where they go afterwards much more easily. And if you get a new pastel set, take the time to, when it's brand new, to sharpen the end without the number on it, and then put them back in an orderly fashion where they go. These kind of tips, believe me, go a long way in helping you paint, because you create a rhythm when you paint. You want to, you know, you want to try to do everything you can. These are little nuts and bolts work habits that are really important. You're going to see almost a greenish color, but it's really brown. And it's like a greenish brown, add yellow, and you have her hair color. Now, if I was painting, I could do that immediately. But with pastel, I have to do my best to find it. And if I can't find exactly that color because I don't have it, then I go to my next best choice. Now I'm moving into some of the lights. Remember, our light source is coming from our top right. And so it's only natural there'll be light areas up on her left forehead, our right. Now, an example of you can't do everything at once, her lips are actually pretty dark, and I really neglected to work on them much, but you can't do everything all at once. But I'm going to do something with that now. This is a good place to talk about. There are no erasers in art, okay? I made this lip color. I put it way down onto her sort of the lower part outside of it. Now, I'm not erasing, but what I'm doing, I'm going to come back over top of it as a corrective measure. I'm really drawing here by encroaching on the part where I went outside the line, so to speak. I'm shaping the lips by drawing outside of it, if that makes sense. So when you make corrections, there's no erasers. So that's one of the reasons in the beginning you do this lightly, that there's such a small amount of pastel on the paper at this point. Now, there's a temptation to draw the pupil in her iris, you know, in the eye. Don't do that, not yet. I might sometimes, depending on the eye, I might do a little very, very light indication of it just to give me more of a mental image of form. But there's plenty of time for that later. Now, what I'm going to do, as I said, I want to redraw. And it's a critical, important part of all aspects of painting. What I mean by redraw is restructure. I'm looking for errors that, whether form, heights, distances between features, whatever. Or I might think of something I did not think of earlier and I want to add that into it. So the best way to quickly look and find some difficulties in it is in the mirror. So I'm going to go back to that, and then I'm going to redraw and then start the procedure and darken the darks. And as I move towards the middles and in lights, I'll lighten the lights, and that'll make the piece further advanced. And it's easy to get enamored with your own work, and you have to really train yourself to be objective and make these kind of corrections when you review what you want to do then in the mirror. So I'm in the redrawing stage again. Notice that I'm drawing more with pencil now In the beginning, I used pastel. It was a little more general, and I knew I'd have the opportunity later. It's kind of moving from the general to the more specific. And remember, at this stage, I'm not making it as dark as I eventually will. Now I'm becoming aware of the color of the paper more than I had before coming through. As I move further into this, that's something I'll be dealing with just as I go along, which meaning, now you can use the color of the paper depending on what you're doing. You're the artist, but the point is to be aware of it. I'm squinting a lot at this point right now. There's a lot of subtle changes. Believe it or not, you would think not squinting is the way to go, but if you squint, you're back to seeing less eyes, nose, mouth type of objects and more color and texture and darks and lights values. I'm going over top of color. I'm not blending, as I said before. There's a highlight on her right eye lid, or light area, I should say, that I completely missed before, and I'm putting an indication of it there, and you just see how that made the eye stronger. This eye here has the light coming from the upper right, so that's going to be lighter. On this side, it's different. And there's this kind of natural tendency to want to mimic what you do with each eye, fight against it, because they're different. You can see how the likeness is taking shape here. As I put these highlights in the hair, you could see how what came before is supporting it. I'm going to put a little bit of her ear tone in here and then on both ears. Okay, because I know when I work on the eyes, when I lighten the eyes, what I just did will get darker without touching it. It's interesting. Part of her eyelashes look like an extremely dark gray. The other part looks more brown, but I'm gonna use a gray. Do the eye, I'm left-handed. In my case, I do the eye to my right first. That touching it to the tongue helps it flick off better. And then now I can see the eye on my left. I can see what I just did when I put the highlight on the eye in my left. So I can make them work together, as opposed to covering one up. Nothing substitutes practice. I'm going to try to strengthen the form a little bit as I finish this out. There is no substitute for experience and practice. You could, all the lessons in the world, if you walk away and don't practice what you learned, it's basically impossible to improve. This is all I'm going to do today for demonstration purposes. In the future, you'll be able to see the finished portrait on my website, www.vincetheartist.com, in the portrait gallery. I want to thank Molly for sitting for me today for this demonstration, and thank everybody for watching, and I hope you learned something new about this that you did not know before.